Good evening. Welcome to the Solon Planning Commission for Tuesday, March 14th, 2023. We'd like to start with a Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, welcome everyone. We'd like to have the roll called now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Here.
Mr. Greenspan?
Here.
Mayor Kraus? Mayor Kraus?
Here.
Mr. Newberry? Ms. Sutton?
Here.
There are no changes to the agenda tonight, so we will roll right along. Now, there are two times in the meeting when someone who's not a party to the agenda item or an agenda item who wants to comment on an agenda item would be more than welcome to come up and talk. Come on, whoever wants to go, yeah. That mic, any of those microphones right there, just give us your name and address and then start talking, please.
Hi, my name is Connie Maddage and I live at 5998 Wallings Road in Broadview Heights. But I own the property next to 7424 on Liberty Road. My family has owned it for 50 years. There's a man here now. It's not on the agenda, but so is that why I talk about the other thing that's happening?
Yeah, you talk about whatever you want, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. So I'm not happy that it's such a big house, that it did get the variance. It's pretty big. I would hope that when my children decide to build something on that house, they get the consideration that you did. But right now, my cousin Lori lives on the other side of the lot, and she, since I'm not there a lot, she has brought to my attention that there's some trespassing on my lot, some things being done, and I wanted to address that. I guess there has been some brush and trees taken down without my knowledge, mine or my husband's knowledge, and, you know, has it been? And I don't mind what goes on. I just would like some consideration. I can give you our name and number. If you want to do something, please call us first. It is our property. Somebody does own it. I just want some consideration for my property. It's not just a dumping ground. It's not just an access. When you want to do your work, it's owned by somebody for many years. And my cousin Lori has taken pictures. I guess there's ATVs now on it. There's been some trees cut down. We have some pictures. Can I ask if this is true? I mean, does he get to speak now or what? No? Just okay. So I guess
I'm making statements.
I guess maybe now have a city official or something just go see what my lot line is. And my husband is going to come out. Like I said, we're busy people. We live in Broadview Heights. My husband is going to come out soon and look at the property himself. I was there earlier and I did see stuff cleared and stuff on it that, you know, and we don't want to be unreasonable, just we want consideration for our property.
Thank you.
Okay. So I would like, when you do call, I would like, you know, Lori has been fortunate to watch our property for us, and we much look, like talking to you, I guess, since you are our neighbor.
Wouldn't have been hard to make a phone call, like I said.
Well, it would have been nice to not encroach on somebody's property that you do not own, also.
Yes,
okay.
Thank you.
I've had one interaction.
Name and address?
Oh, I'm sorry.
No problem.
I'm Lorene McCuna, 7398 Liberty Road. I live two lots north of the 7424 property, and I routinely on occasion get agendas for plannings and changes of variances. My last time here was 2020 in March when an initial home was proposed there on that property, a 50-foot back and a 10-foot variance, and very clearly we had said that we wanted a 20-foot variance to blend in with the rest of the entire neighborhood on Liberty Road. Since then, when that home did go up with the building, I never got, that to my knowledge, it was around 2021 during the COVID times, any type of information. And I do want you to know that this information we're getting, as far as when these meetings occur, come very late. This one was sent on March 3rd, apparently. It did not reach our homes till March 10th, after the time we could have actually made a phone call. So, the March 2020 time when that home went up was, they were in Florida, so I represented them also. You don't want to deter neighbors, you want them to go according to the zoning laws. And variances are an exception to a zoning law. We've had water there, so on and so forth. So what I'm going to show you is, September 18th, I noticed that there was a lot of wood chips thrown on the lot. I noticed that there was a lot of brush cleared. A lot of damage was done. There was a lot of dumping on the ground. So I'm going to start showing you some pictures of September 18th. They have a 10-foot variance. This is clearly 20 to 30 feet into the property. Here's the chainsaw on our property I should have taken. This was all wooded at one time. The landscaping was taken place on their property, and this lot that stood within this family for 50 years that was untouched was used as a dumping ground.
So I got a quick question here. So if I'm looking at this picture, everything on the left is your property, right? And everything
it pretty much goes along the tree line at the top of the picture. This was all woods or brush that kept people from deterring.
So the big tree on the right, you're saying that's where you...
That's a telephone pole that I think just went up recently.
So
I don't know.
That's
on their property. I'll show you.
Property.
I'll find one.
Well, I mean, it'd have to be surveyed for us to know and see exactly where it's going on, all kind of stuff, right? I just want to get clarification under your...
Here is the owner's property, you can see, and then this is the roughed up area. All of this here is not his property, and this was all woods.
It would be helpful if there was... flags marking the property line. And Mr. Chairman, this is all.
Yeah.
This is one here. Apparently.
And so there's one. And where's
that was just one. The rest is removed. Yeah.
Here's the next one.
That is the only one that was there.
We have a point. We have a point of reference.
Yes.
It takes two points to make a line, right? And so you could have been faced this way, right? You could have been twisted around.
I was there tonight and I saw it.
I don't have a proper point of reference to make a judgment as to whose property is what.
We can't
quite
do
frankly,
that here. Yeah, we can't
that's
do that
not
here.
Part of this, not part of the purview of this commission. If you have an issue with the way your neighbor's house is being built, you need to get a hold of the building department in the city of Solon and or the police department.
Okay.
We can't do anything about it here.
Oh, I appreciate it. I understand a 1-inch to a 12-inch, so I will have to get another marker to declare a straight line. But
well, you need a surveyor to put the marker in, too. It's not just
yes. Yes.
And we will address you to how to get that.
Absolutely.
Thank you. But yesterday, this is the problem that I'm dealing with now. An ATV came through the property line that was cleared and is now moving on to the vacant lot. And it went through this line all the way through and then came up through the middle. And there were tracks, and I do have further pictures, but this is basically, and it went behind their residence property, and I don't know where the ATV went. Before this happened, there was no way people could get through that. As far as the variance, I want to go with the zoning laws. I don't want any variances further.
Thank you. Okay, are there more comments, please, Mr. Griffith?
They're bad, you know my name.
if you put more than name tag.
Anyway, Ray Griffith, 35825 Spice Bush Lane. Again, I'm here tonight as one of the four board members of the Preserve HOA regarding the pod at 35625 Spice Bush. I understand at caucus tonight that the residents have decided to, or the residents have actually listened to the Planning Commission, and they've agreed to empty out the pod and move it off the site. And that the Planning Commission is going to make a vote on the final action on this pod. So we really, the residents of the Homeowners Association really appreciate the support that this commission was able to encourage these homeowners to move on and join our community. So appreciate the help. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comments from the audience regarding any agenda item, but you're not a party to the agenda item? Anyone else want to talk about anything? Seeing no takers, we'll move on. We have a set of minutes here we need to deal with.
Yeah, I move to adopt the Planning Commission minutes from February 28th, 2023.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Krause?
Abstain.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Our next agenda item is our pending agenda item. We have three of these going on tonight. So the first pending agenda item is 35625 Spice Bush Lane. David and Donna Biggers. So we are going to go ahead and make a motion and vote on this one tonight.
So we can make a motion in the negative.
No, I prefer if you make a motion in the affirmative, so no means no, and yes means yes. So.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Motion to grant.
All right, I'll make a motion to grant the accessory structure location variance at 35625 Spice Bush Lane.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to have a vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
No.
Mr. Greenspan?
No.
Mayor Krause?
No.
Mr. Newberry?
No.
Ms. Sutton?
No.
Thank you. Can you explain just for everyone, please, what the options now for?
Yeah, the clerk will provide notice to the applicant of the commission's action that the variance has been denied. They will have 14 days, if they chose, to appeal to city council the decision of this commission. Factually, what I know about this, I could not anticipate it, but that would be their right.
Thank you. We have to explain all the options, what's going on here. I think Mr. Griffin's explained that it is empty and it was supposed to be gone yesterday. Unfortunately, the pod people did not come pick it up, and the pod people are going to come get it by Friday, so it will be gone by the end of this week. The pod people have told them by the end of this week it should be gone out of there. So it should take care of everyone's concerns at that point. So our next agenda item after that is a public hearing, and I need to explain. 6958 Som Center Road, permanent parcels number 954-18022. Oh, it's one, because we're splitting it. Okay. So that's the agenda item. So I'm going to open the public hearing for this one because it is a lot split. We have a public hearing for anyone from the public has any questions, comments, concerns about this one. Public hearing is open. Do we any takers who want to talk about this particular agenda item? Seeing none, we'll ask the applicants to come on up, please. Mr. and Mrs. Egan? I guess Mr. Egan. Yeah.
Good evening.
Hey.
Kevin Egan and
Kate Egan.
6958 Som Center Road.
Okay. Welcome.
Thanks.
Welcome.
If you don't have any, reach behind you and grab your packet and then show us like the site plan. It should be behind you in order there. You'd be the second one there, probably. I'm sorry. I forgot to explain that in caucus to you guys.
You did. I'm sorry.
No, I
didn't. I need to be told things twice sometimes. Apologize for that. All right. So.
Salt.
All right. Here's the site plan. Proper orientation. Yeah. Look it up.
Please, yes.
Go ahead.
All right, so do you want me to walk you through what kind of we're planning?
Well, yeah, because we're dealing with a lot split right now, right? So this is the lot split, so what we're doing. So show us the existing lot and show us where you propose to split it, please.
Yep. Existing lot is outlined in blue here on this diagram. Proposed split is the line down, directly down the center. in red, or somewhat down the center. The goal here is to mimic the adjacent lots. They're kind of referred to as bowling alley lots a lot of times. A little bit of history, which is pretty cool about this property. 163 years old, century home. Wow. One of the oldest in Solon.
Cool.
We love it. We really do. And so we've been trying to get creative about how to use it, how to utilize it more efficiently for our growing family and growing family needs as well with aging parents. So really, we've kind of wrestled on how to do it. We've proposed to do it in the past. And I guess, a commendation to this current administration, I'm just grateful for the willingness to even work and entertain it again. Mr. Parks here has been super helpful. On a side note, I didn't get direct recommendations from him, but he at least helped guide me through the process, whereas I didn't necessarily get that in the past. So I really appreciate that. So that being said, taking it back off the table and putting it back in front of your kind faces. And so, yeah, the goal is to split it down the middle and see what I can do with it. The goal is not to just build a house, flip it for cash. The goal is really to utilize it for our family's needs. I ideally would have done that by just adding a separate structure. I know that opens up a whole nother can of worms in terms of zoning if I add a separate structure with another sanitary line to it. So that being said, if I don't go through a rezoning process, which I really don't want to go door to door and petition all of Ward 7, but or is it Ward 2 now that the boundaries have changed? Anyhow, not minor details, but at the same time, so that brings us to the lot split again. Yep, seeking to split it again. It does create another lot non-conforming to the width, requesting a variance to that width, lot width variance. Mr. Stolarski, if you have any other concerns, like for sure, I'd love to speak to those or at least help you understand anything too.
I mean, I thank you. I understand what's going on here. I just feel obligated to advise the commission that we do have a residential growth management policy, which the creation of a non-conforming lot, contiguous under common ownership, is disfavored under that policy. And but the commission can do as they wish.
Yeah, and I mean overall, as a Solon resident, I get it. I get the idea of a zoning code, and I'm appreciative of it. I'm appreciative of the way our city looks. I get it from kind of working in that industry as well. So there's rules. I want to follow them, and I appreciate the design and the intent of most of those rules as well. So
perfect. Thank you, Mr. Egan.
Yeah.
Well put. I should probably talk a little bit about the background about why this came into fruition when we changed our codes to make 1 acre minimum lots where you could build a house on. But the exception that I talked about in caucus is that if you looked, can you show one of the plans, which one was it here, that showed the everything, all the lots next to you up and down the street?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
All right. And I can't find it over here.
And that was a snapshot I pulled directly off of the county GIS, the GIS real property county.
Right, perfect, thank you. So the exception that we always make is when the lots are, you call them bowling alley lots, are all like this. So they are contextual, and it'd be different if all the other lots in that neighborhood were 2 acres and you wanted to make a bowling alley lot there, that just wouldn't be contextually, it wouldn't fit contextually. When you're making, you're splitting that one in half, the one circling yellow, or almost in half the way you have it, it's contextual with all the other lots on that street and across the street too. So that's really the only exception that we will make variance to make a non-conforming lot.
Sure, and it's kind of funny because this plat originally, so right now you're seeing an acre and a half left. It was originally 300 acres. So,
oh my gosh,
if there was any precedent set with the previous lot splits, it's kind of cool. All these surrounding parcel numbers. Mm-hmm. I mean, the first five numbers of the parcels, I don't think they're coincidentally 95418 everywhere in that area.
Yeah, that has to do with the old way of defining the parcels. 951 is the book. 44 is the page, and then the individual parcels are numbered beyond that.
Gotcha.
That's the way it was set up. But you're right. I mean, the, you know, the original books are 18 by 24.
Yeah.
And, you know, each page in that book is about 600 to 800 acres, depending on where it is.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So if you look, if you, and you, you can actually, when you look at the books, you, and you can do it online now, too, you can look back at the pages to watch how the giant lots, the farm lots, got smaller and smaller and smaller.
Wow. That's amazing. I mean, that tells a story in itself.
It is fascinating.
And yeah, and that's what I mean. I overall, we loved the property. We loved the idea that maybe Garfield was riding his buggy down 91 right in front of our house. You know, it was there before the Civil War. Mm-hmm. You know, which has all sorts of history. You know, tied into with the North being.
Come on, I guess the road wasn't four lanes wide and
yeah,
asphalt.
Exactly. You know,
two buggies wide.
Yeah, horse and buggy path originally. You know, or even an Indian trail before that. So,
Not that straight.
Well, no, okay.
There would have been a tree in the way, and they would have gone off.
Oh, yeah.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, yep. Absolutely. Any other questions, comments, concerns from commission members?
No. Great. In that case, I'll be happy to make a motion to grant a lot split pending for permanent parcel number 954-1822. Contingent upon the items included in the engineer's memo.
I second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to have a vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Krause?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
I'll make a motion for a 12.5-foot lot with variance at the same address.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to vote, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Krause?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
One more.
I move for the variance to not combine non-conforming lots.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to have a vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Krause?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
Perfect. So I'd like to close the public hearing on that particular item and let our applicants know that we will need you for about 10 minutes, 5 minutes probably tops, at the City Council meeting on Monday, March 20th in the caucus room right at 7 o'clock, 5 minutes total.
Okay. Do you need us both or can I just represent? Oh, is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
One of you is fine, but you could bring her and take her out.
She's the better face by far.
you're welcome to send Katie. Yeah. She could probably do a good job.
Yeah, she's much better representative.
You can take her out to L afterwards, one of the nice restaurants in town here.
Yeah, she deserves that too. All right. Well, thank you all so much for your time and your support. Appreciate it.
Yep.
Good night. Okay, our next agenda item is 35100 Aurora Road. This is Solon Community Living. Mr. Bialis is going to talk to us tonight. Where are you? Hey, come on, Gary. And then, yes, we're excited to hear from him.
Well, good to be back. Gary Bialis. I am a board member of Solon Community Living, and I live at 32870 Wintergreen Drive, Solon, Ohio. And Ira is also here.
Sure. I'll join him. Ira Bagdasarian, 6790 Ridgecliff Drive, Solon.
So I have a site plan here just to start off with. There's a lot of things that came up last meeting, which I did ask to be tabled, that I would admit I wasn't prepared for, and now I think I'm better prepared. Let me start off with this site plan is the plan that has been approved by Planning Commission City Council. This shows you the different units which are here. There's basically 14 residents total, and we also have six caregivers. There's one in each building. They're actually on a second floor with an external entrance in. Okay. So one question came up last, why did we design it for 20 years? I should have been better knowledgeable. Well, I designed it because that's what ODOT designs all their roads to. There's no other design. It's 20 years. Every road in Solon is designed for 20 years. I actually went as far to call GPD, your consultant, and ask, what's he designing the roads for? 20 years. So actually, he designed Aurora Road, and it was engineer Dave Neumeier. So that's how we came up to 20-year design. ODOT requires it for all public roads. This is a private road. For all public roads, you have, for your public roads, are 20 years. I went back to the soil consultant and asked him, and I know there was a memo that I sent, a letter that came out yesterday or today about our road. And I went back to him, I said, what would you have to do to make this last for 30 years? He came back, and basically, if you read his letter, he says, your road will last for 30 years. In fact, if you wanted to go to 20 years, you could reduce an inch of pavement. I'm not reducing an inch of pavement, okay? But again, he based it on the traffic. And that's what almost one of the most important things to do. You base your road on how much traffic you're going to have. And I'm going to read from his if you want to know how much traffic for this particular road, he was very, he wasn't conservative. And I'll read right down here. He figured that on this road, which has 14 residents, 6 caregivers, that doesn't cut through, it's, you only go one in a circle, 200 cars per day, 50 pickup trucks per day, 15 package delivery trucks per week, 2 garbage trucks per week, and 2 semi-tractors per week, okay? He takes those loads, and I know I'm getting technical here, the loads of those cars and trucks are the most important because they're heaviest loads, and he puts it in a model, and they say, okay, what pavement do I have there? How much stone, how much asphalt do I need? And that's how he arrived at his design, okay? So his design will take care of those loads. He actually says now in his letter, it will take it for 30 years, not 20, which that's probably good for Ara because he won't have to maintain it as often. He'll still have to maintain it, he won't have to replace it, okay? So that's one item. I think there's actually a flaw in your code. I'm not going to change that. The fact that you're telling a private road owner that he has to build to a certain thickness of pavement as public roads, okay? You don't do that anywhere else for your code. You don't say, I have to have a 4-inch water line to my building. You design it based on the need. Sewer lines, storm, sanitary, based on the flows. You base it on actual conditions. You don't base it on just, oh, it should be this much. Now, it's a great design, but that road's going to last for 50 or 100 years. Okay, so that's a flaw, but I can't get around that flaw because it's in your code. But it is a flaw because everything else you design per calculations. Stormwater basins, how big are they? Well, it's based on the flow. So the fact that we have to design per your code, I understand it. But even your code, if you look at, I'm going to show you one other thing. You're building Aurora Road now. Aurora Road design. So I got the design, the drawing. Actually, John Bush gave it to me, and I talked to the engineer about it. This road, if you would have met your requirements of 9 inches of asphalt and 3 inches of stone, which is down here, you didn't build it per city code. You built it with 12 inches of asphalt, 6 inches of base, and they did a thing called cement stabilization. That's where they mix cement with the subbase. So why'd you build it greater than what says in your code? Because the traffic requires that. Your engineer designed it per the traffic requirements. That's why it's bigger. And that's fine. He should do it. He should base it. There's a lot of trucks on Aurora Road, a lot of semis on Aurora Road. So you should actually say in your code, you have to build to a 20-year design based on the soils and traffic. And then everybody would design it per ODOT. That's why we're designing it the way. Now, I do understand that part of our road, I'm back on the site plan, there's areas here that are in the right-of-way. I have in green. I agree. That's your right-of-way. We'll build it to the requirement that you have. But I really do think that you're asking, the code is asking for more than is needed here. We have a 30-year road that we're designing it to. Your code only requires more pavement than I need. And then you'll say, well, how is this unique, this project? And I'm going to tell you how it's unique. Because everybody says, why should you get a variance? How's it different than anybody else? Some things are specifically unique here. Other things, if you add them together, they're unique. So one is, let me go to my list here. First of all, it's zone RC3, only property in zone for in Solon, that zoning, okay? There's 14 individuals here, none of them drive, okay? That's unique. There's no expansion here. There's no way to expand here. So it's not like, oh, later on you have more traffic. There's no cut-throughs. A lot of times you have roads and you have cut-throughs. Well, this is a ring that goes nowhere. This serves the community. It's interesting because a lot of times you have communities like the golf course signature, and those are each individual homeowners, and they must pay into a fund because that's a private road, but somebody has to fix it. This is all owned by Solon Community Living. These aren't individual lots. It's one lot with structures on it, okay? So you have one owner that has to maintain the road, and they're responsible for the maintenance. In fact, some of the rent, there is, I don't know the whole structure of how Ara is doing his project, but there is a portion that the residents will pay rent every month. Part of that goes to a maintenance fund, so there is money there. So you don't have individual owners says, I don't have money to pay for this, you don't have money. He set up a fund to make it so if there's an issue in 20 years, if there's cracks in 3 years, whatever it is, he has to maintain the road, he has a fund to maintain the road. So those were seven items I gave you, and I think no other project in Solon, I know no other project has those seven items because no other project has zoned RC3. No other project has only residents that don't drive. And that's why I think this project is unique, and that's why, based on 30-year road, based on the circumstances, the traffic flow, our engineer designing it per ODOT standards, I think that's why I'm asking for variance to the section that I've requested. Now I'll answer questions.
Thank you. Very thorough. Thank you. I guess my only, our engineering department is pretty strict about how they want things done and say, and that's just the way they are. I guess everything they do is for this our safety, for everyone's safety. So that, you know, everything that they. Every decision they come up with is based on the safety of everyone that lives in Solon, and that's just that's. I mean, you know, that's, I'll defend them a little bit on that one for sure. So, anybody else?
Yeah, I think the last time I said in the last meeting, it's I don't have an issue with it. I'm glad they got a second opinion. There's, you know, very often we go by just. What people say and to have a backup is reassuring that this road's going to last. And it is a private road, so the city is not obligated to fix it if it needs fixing. And again, I think it's a unique piece of property where it doesn't follow any other type of standards in Solon with its design. That's why it has its own unique zoning code. So I don't have a problem moving forward with this.
Thank you.
I'll chime in. Think that the presentation you gave just makes sense. You know, sometimes you got to look at the traffic. That's why we do things, you know, differently on Aurora Road than we would do here. You have to be smart about this. Going with what ODOT does makes a lot of sense. We go by what ODOT does. You know, sometimes we agree with them, sometimes we don't agree with them. Being a private development, I think, is very different than a, you know, highly traveled road. I think the residents here do not drive. And the fact that this road is going to last, you know, 20 to 30 years makes sense. This project's been going on for a long time. We've had a lot of give and take. We've asked a lot, and you've asked a lot. But in the end, I mean, that's a true partnership. I mean, that's how things get done. If we don't have partnerships in this city, we won't have anything. We won't have any development. We won't have any amazing projects like this unless we commit to a true partnership. And a true partnership is give and take. You can't have everything. You can't have everything that you want, and just like you can't have everything you want. So I support this because, you know, it makes sense for, you know, the reasons that you numbered.
Okay, I guess we can go ahead.
Nope, not yet.
Go ahead.
I don't know where to start. There are a number of things that you mentioned, Mr. Vialis, in your presentation, which are subject to some debate.
Okay.
Let's talk about Aurora Road, first of all. That's a state highway. It is funded by the state of Ohio. It has to be built to state of Ohio criteria. One of the things that is heavily considered in the state of Ohio in a exurban road like this is the condition of the soils underneath. The reason for the cement stabilization, oh, by the way, the sections you showed, the one that shows all the cement stabilization is for about 536.5 feet,
okay,
of a road that is 14,800 feet long, okay? So it's a relatively small piece of it. But be that as it may, ODOT stipulates the requirements for the pavement section based on the amount of traffic they expect and also the condition of the soils underneath, okay? And the expected use of the road, obviously, too. My biggest concern with, so this doesn't apply to the ring road around Solon Family Living. It doesn't apply to any other residential street in the city. This applies probably more on Somme Center and Aurora Road than any other street. Even Pettibone and Brainerd and Liberty and all the other county highways do not have to meet this criteria. Only the state highways do. If we grant the variance to allow the reduction in pavement, and I think I explained this one last time you were here, that there's a good reason for that, would Solon Family Community Living be willing to accept a covenant not to request in perpetuity that this road be dedicated to for public use?
Can you answer that? I can't. He can answer that.
This is why I'm asking the question.
I move aside. You'll never come back.
That's a new question.
Mr. Bagdasarian is not going to be the owner of this property the developer forever.
What happens?
So we have another sample up at the corner of Somme and Cannon Road where there was a private development. And as soon as the original developer walked away from the project, basically as soon as he turned it over to the HOA, they immediately came to the city and asked for the variance. Even though they were well aware of what the conditions of the road were when it was built, they were well aware of the variance that had been granted and the reasons why the city granted the variance. They were denied.
Okay.
They were not able to make that road public because they had already said they weren't going to.
I agree. It should have denied them. In fact, our, as you know, I've received variances already that doesn't make this meet the requirements. The width of it, you know, you have a lot of items that I don't make that it would make a public road.
So the width is significant in because of the anticipated use and the location of this road. I get that.
Yeah.
I don't have any problem with that. I'm much more concerned about the structural strength of the road. And whether it lasts 20 or 30 years doesn't matter. You know, we had 100-year rain last week. We're going to have another 100-year rain next week. It's all statistics.
Right.
It doesn't matter. And quite frankly, the difference between a 20-year road and a 30-year road is that a 20-year road needs significant repair 10 years in, right? A 30-year road needs significant repairs about 11 or 12 years in. It just doesn't make that much difference.
Right. And you can see that in the Solon roads because they're all built per ODOT requirements. And I know you mentioned a smaller road. Even smaller roads, your engineer, the chief highway GPD, designs his roads to ODOT requirements. Not say it's not an ODOT road.
See, all of us engineers rely on a book called the ODOT location, Ohio Department of Transportation, Location and Design Manual.
Yes.
This happens to be volume one, okay? That's what we rely on as the basis for our design.
Right.
It is the minimum standard requirements that we have to meet.
Right.
Minimum.
Right.
Not the maximum, but not the only.
And I'm over that by an inch, according to my engineer. But that's fine, I don't want to argue this.
Yeah. Well, I'm just, you know, there's all kinds of things we could talk about back and forth.
Okay.
I remain in support of the city engineering department because I believe that is the best situation for the city of Solon. The exception I would make is if Solon Community Living is willing to covenant to the city that they will never ask for the road to be made public unless it's brought up to the city's specifications in terms of pavement. I'm okay with that.
And I'm just trying to clarify the fire scene. So if they ever asked for it, they'd have to bring it up to that
Before it's granted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, then it becomes the design you want.
Right. And that's exactly what happened up at Wallingford.
Okay.
They were willing to make that covenant.
Right.
Right. They were willing to say at the time they made the covenant that it was never going to be ceded over to the city. I think it was 7 years later, 5 years later, they came and asked.
Yeah. So it's basically our asphalt is 4 inches. We have more stone, but we have more asphalt or less asphalt.
Mm-hmm.
So to bring it up exactly, you'd have to add 4 inches of asphalt. Even though you have 8 inches of stone, Roger. That doesn't enter into
the... And there's a way around that too.
I know that.
Because the asphalt design in the ODOT manual is what we call full depth.
Yeah.
It's all asphalt. There's very little aggregate except to make a leveling course. The design you're using has an aggregate base to develop support for the pavement.
It's getting a little technical, I know. I'm sorry. That's what happens when we get two engineers talking to each other.
About getting schooled.
Damn straight. Yeah, about time.
Okay, let our talk.
No, so the equivalent of what, in other words, because we've already got 8 inches of gravel, would have to be equivalent if we were ever to come back and do that. Well, I really wanted to say that originally we wanted a public road, and I think as the mayor said, there's give and take. You know, we now own the responsibility for trash, for plowing, all those things, and to do it to the city spec would cost at least another $50,000, which would burden the project. I think, my opinion, not being an engineer, my opinion after listening to everything excessively. So I appreciate what you've said. I didn't think about that coming in. I think I'd be willing to speak for the community to say, yeah, we would agree to that. Because I didn't have any intention to come back again and ask to have it become a public road.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And that's the answer I expected.
Yeah, I mean, I think integrity is part of what we want to be as partners. As the mayor said, we've been at this 7 years now. You've seen me enough, I think. We just want to break ground, and there's a lot of people, you know, counting on me to make sure I can deliver what I've been promising here. So I would appreciate that variance, and I would accept that commitment that we would not ask for a public road unless we brought it up to the city code.
Thank you. I'm okay. Jacob?
Mr. Chairman, just real quick, I just want to clarify for the record, because I know a lot of people have been throwing out a bunch of different technical things on how engineer designs roads. City of Solon is a charter community. We're actually not subject to ODOT rules and regulations. We don't have to follow any ODOT rules and regulations. Now, with like Aurora Road, because it is a state-funded project, we do have to meet their minimums. However, like the cement stabilization is actually not a requirement per the roadway design for Aurora Road. That's something additional that Solon, over the years of experience of seeing how the roads react and handle, that's an additional cost that City of Solon bears for cement stabilization because it isn't part of ODOT. The specifications that were referenced that are in the code that they're requesting the variance for, that was approved by council back in 1991. That is what council at that time decided the minimum standards were, based upon just the past experiences from the city of Solon. So I know keeps going back to ODOT. Yes, that is the general standard of Ohio. But just wanted to clarify for the record that city of Solon is not mandated by ODOT rules or requirements as a charter community.
Thank you. All right.
Okay.
Anybody else? Any comments? No. Okay. All right. Where are we here?
I'm ready to make a motion.
I can, yeah. So I move for the 2-inch pavement depth variance at 35100 Aurora Road.
Roger, you going to add the contingent?
Contingent upon the items in the engineer's memo.
That's fair.
And contingent upon the applicant signing a covenant not to, ask for the road to become public in perpetuity.
Yeah. I'll second that.
That's fair.
Unless they fix it.
It's fine.
Bring it up to.
Right, right. Well, yeah, the language of the covenant still needs.
Yeah, can we get something clear for the clerk? I mean, so, oh, you have it? Okay, we're good.
The covenant?
The legal department.
The covenant.
Legal department will work with the applicant.
You? Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. We had a second to that. We had a motion and a second.
Yes.
I forgot to tell what I felt about this. I'm going to vote in the affirmative because it's up to the applicant to fix it if it's broken. It's a private road, just like where I live. It's a private road. So if something breaks, then they have to fix it and take care of it. So there's no onus on the city to do that. And if they ever came back, of course, they wanted the city to take it over. I might try that in my neighborhood, see what the city says to us. But I don't see that ever happening. So we'd like to vote now, please. Thank you.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. So what's the date here? The 10th. It's March 20th. Caucus, 7 o'clock. You know.
Thank you,
gentlemen. All right. Next agenda item, 7424 Liberty Road. Mr. McGrill is here. Hello.
Hello. I am overjoyed to be here this evening. Scott McGrill, 7424 Liberty Road. Some of you know, we built our first house in Solon in 2005 in Signature. And given how incredibly, when my wife and I decided to downsize out of our house in Signature into the house that we built on Liberty Road, we debated moving to South Carolina or staying in Solon. I love the city of Solon. Given how easy it is to get things accomplished in the city of Solon, and in particular because of the incredibly warm neighborly welcome I've gotten from the folks over here, I'm ecstatic that we decided to build this house on Liberty Road. So we'll address that privately. If anybody here has questions, I'm happy to answer them. And there were originally two things we wanted to talk about tonight. After caucus, despite the fact that there are dirt driveways, blacktop driveways, cement driveways, gravel driveways, cement driveways with pavers next to them, I've elected just to withdraw the whole discussion about the pavers at the end of the driveway. We'll deal with it. I'll put gravel down or come up with some other solution. So the only thing we're here for tonight is to talk about my understanding of a variance of a 0-foot setback that's required to put in two light poles, basically, with stone pillars on either side of the driveway. I've seen the engineering memo. I understand there's a survey required. Happy to comply with whatever's needed there to get it staked and figure out what the exact location is. So that's it. Pictures here. It's really just these two spots.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yep. Happy to answer any questions.
I think we covered everything in caucus there pretty.
So is the variance 30 feet?
I guess it would be a 30-foot decorative wall setback with a contingency that it not be in the right-of-way and that it be surveyed to confirm that.
I'm not sure I follow the 30 feet. Nick said it was 20 feet setback, right?
Yes, it's a 20-foot setback from the road. The 30-foot requirement is from the property line, so the variance would be 30
okay.
feet closer than what is permitted for a 0-foot front yard setback
okay.
variance.
Got it.
Also, there is one thing that should be noted for the record as it was brought up during the presentation. Gravel would also not be a permitted material to put at the end of the driveway.
Within the city.
So he said you're going to handle it.
So despite, okay.
Yep.
Astounding to me. Okay.
All right, I will move for a 30-foot decorative wall front yard setback variance with the contingency of the engineering memo and also that a survey be done at 7424 Liberty.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to have a vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Krause?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
I'll move to accept the withdrawal of the required construction material variance at the same address.
I second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to have a vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Krause?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
All right, so Mr. McGurl, we'll need you here on Monday, March 20th, in the caucus room at 7 o'clock. It's like 5 minutes top.
You'll get to see my lovely wife as I'll be out of town.
Well, I can't wait to see her then, for sure.
Okay.
Thank you. All right. Our next agenda item is for 32001 Cannon Drive. This is the Church of the Resurrection.
Good evening, Marco Ciccarelli, 1163 East 40th Street, Cleveland, Ohio, the architect for Church of the Resurrection. We are looking at putting up an 8-foot fence around a mechanical unit to replace a 6-foot high masonry wall that currently exists there. I think there are two variances. One was for the height of the fence and the other was for the openness. We are withdrawing the request for a solid fence and we'll provide a fence with 25% opening as requested by the Planning Commission. The location is sort of behind the building. This is an example of the masonry wall that is in existence. This would be the 6-foot high wall that's there right now. It's in disrepair, and the easy solution for us is to take that down and create a new enclosure with a vinyl fence, which we will, in the same shape, in the same area of the foundations. And I think we have some images of it here. And like I said, color is the same, so it's a wood look vinyl fence, 8 foot tall, and then we will do a board on board rather than a solid fence to achieve the openness.
Thank you.
Questions?
So I should explain why, what the 25% fence visibility variance comes from. It's the our public safety teams, police and fire, when they come up on any kind of a scene, they like to be able to see through the fence and make sure no one's hiding behind them that was going to do anything nefarious. So they like to have that 25% visibility, so you know, to keep themselves safe and keep us safe as well. We appreciate you working with us to get that done. The height variance, we understand exactly. Your unit there is a little bigger. It's a little taller.
It's a little taller.
So we're okay with having it shielded over there from that side of, we got a big parking lot over there, and we understand and support you on getting it a little higher so we can hide the good stuff back there, the necessary stuff back there that we have, so it's not visible to everyone to the naked eye. Okay, anybody else?
Nope. Easy.
I'll happy to make a motion for a 2-foot fence height variance at 32001 Cannon Road.
I second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. We would like to have a vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Krause?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
Thank you.
And I'll make the motion again to accept the applicant's withdrawal of the 25% fence visibility variance at 32001 Cannon.
Second.
Do we need to make any contingency about that? That'll be all be worked out in with planning in the future.
They'll work with planning, and as long as they meet the requirement, it won't be a variant. So,
yeah.
It'll be through the application process.
Right.
Okay. No contingency. Okay. All right. For that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Now we need to vote.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
Stop it. Leave me alone. Okay, so Monday, March 20th again.
Perfect.
5 minutes. Whoever's closer can come.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a great evening.
Good seeing you again. The gentleman again. All right. Now we come to the part of the meeting where we have comments from the audience. If anyone in the audience, again, wants to talk about anything at all, we'd love to love to hear from you, comments from the audience. We're going to miss you next week, by the way. Mm-hmm. Next time, we're going to miss you.
Next you're week. Welcome to come. Yeah, you're welcome
come
to
back.
Come.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, just, hey, we just love, we'd like to see your smiling face here, for sure. So, yeah. Seeing no takers, we will go ahead and... comments from the commission and the everyone else here. We'll start with the Chief Joe Eisner, please.
No comments, thank you.
Comments? Any comments from engineering? Mr. Linden?
No comments tonight, thank you.
Okay, good.
No
senior
comments.
Planner?
None tonight, thank you.
Attorney?
Nothing this evening, thank you.
No comments.
No?
No comments.
Mr. Greenspan?
Nothing tonight.
Mr. Roger?
I didn't. Only so? One. And who calls this spring anyway?
That's a good question.
Who's responsible for the temperature today?
I just flip a switch.
That's it? Nothing?
That's it.
All right. Go. Kent State and Sincere Carry. It's a pretty impressive run those young men have been making with Sincere. Everyone should, if they don't know, I will let you know. Sincere Carry actually lives in my ward. He's, him and his mother, just a great young man and an incredible athlete. And everyone's supporting Kent State in their run and his run in the, I believe they're playing Indiana next week. So it should be a, hey, we play the game because anyone can win. Let's go for that. Other than that, I've got no comments. Mayor?
I'm just a little disappointed that it took so long for the pod to be removed, and just appreciate, you know, everyone's willingness to try to work with us. It was a long time, but thanks to the Homeowners Association for bringing our attention, and finally got it removed, and thanks to Sincere, and we also have Mike Bekelja, another Solon graduate at Kent State University on the basketball team, so there's a lots of comet connections to Kent State University. So go Flashes and beat that Big Ten.
Not to mention their equipment manager?
Something like that. That's what he tells me. Some guy named Jacob Krause.
Krause is the equipment manager down there for the basketball team too. So we waste them all.
Little kid can carry all those balls?
He's got big. He's a man.
No little kid anymore.
Exactly. Yeah. All right. With that, I will entertain the motion to adjourn, I guess. We're done.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second, and we would like to vote now, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Greenspan?
Yes.
Mayor Kraus?
Yes.
Mr. Newberry?
Yes.
Ms. Sutton?
Yes.
Thanks, everybody.